Our next guest says we are on the cusp of a revival in economic growth. He says recent earnings reports show a new recession's out of the question. We're joined by Lakshman Achuthan. He's managing director at ECRI. Lakshman, 74% of S&P 500 companies that reported earnings have beat expectations. Mm-hmm. Last time you were on, you said it was the Rodney Dangerfield economy.
Right.
Getting no respect.
Right.
What are we in now?
Well, I think it's gotten a little bit more respect, this recovery. After a bit of double-dip fear that emerged over the summer, I think people have walked away from that. They're looking at the incoming data, the earnings reports, for example, and other leading indicators of the economy, and they're seeing them resilient, moving to the upside. And so when you see this higher-than-expected earnings out of companies, this is something that they're going to want more of, right? This, you know, companies become incentivized, if they're profitable, to do more of whatever they're doing. But customers, the consumers, are coming in the door and purchasing, which is why these earnings are up. And this begins a virtuous cycle. You have more demand, more production, ultimately firmer employment, which I think will be part of the revival in growth, which firms also income, which gets you more spending. This is at the heart of a cyclical revival.
Yeah, because we still are hearing question marks around top line growth. You're getting, you know, fingers pointed to the positives being, mm-hmm. you know, there's a lot of cash there, the cost cutting, we've maxed it out, stretched worker productivity. But you do think that the consumer strength is being underreported?
Yeah, I think that exactly. I think the top line growth, it began to come back. You saw in particular from the consumer side, mm-hmm. With the luxury market very clearly. And then towards the end of last year, both the middle and lower parts of the market, lower economic parts of the market, also started to come in. And therefore, you had a pretty good holiday season. That wasn't, in our view, a flash in the pan or simply a seasonal event, but rather the return of consumption. And we talked about earlier frugality fatigue setting in, where it's just you've gone without for a few years. Mm-hmm. Your savings have come back quite a bit. The home price stopped falling. And even though there's not a strong rebound in hiring yet, for everybody who does have a job, the fear of getting fired has been receding steadily. And with a revival in growth, when we look around the world, we have leading indicators, long leading indicators for 19 economies. The first one that is going to revive is actually the U.S., and that goes a little bit against what you might think on the face of it.
Right. Well, you're hearing a little bit more optimism from Goldman Sachs and like about the growth that is to come here at home.
Right.
You think the word fragile needs to be removed from our vocabulary?
Yeah. There's always a laundry list of things to worry about, and there's news today and shocks and unexpected geopolitical
sovereign
events.
Sovereign debt, still an overhang. You know,
state
what's going to happen with the bailouts? State debt,
yes.
Certainly. I mean, you seem to be a skeptic about these things.
Well, I think that these are very real issues, and I think ultimately they're negatives to growth. However, the vulnerability of the economy, this is a key insight when you study business cycles and recessions, mm-hmm. is that the vulnerability of the economy to a negative shock, or some unexpected event, or things just like this laundry list of things that we worry about, that it's not a constant. Sometimes you're more vulnerable than other times. Just like an immune, it's cold season, right? So, and your immune system gets compromised and you catch a cold.
Right.
And other times you're feeling better and, you know, people have colds and you don't get a cold. Right now, with the forward-looking indicators, the leading indicators, re-accelerating. That's mm-hmm. a way of saying the economy's immune system is actually quite robust here. And so if you get hit, if you get knocked by a shock,
right.
many of them that we're talking about, they're not going to derail the recovery. And therefore, the risk of something bad happening, like double dip or stumbling and this and that, is much lower than people think.
And yet, to take your analogy there, the worry is that we've taken every kind of medicine there possibly is on the market. The
right.
Fed doesn't have anything else. If we do get even a slight cold.
Yeah, no, I'd actually think there's a point where you take too much medicine. Let's go one step further.
You want to see pullback of QE?
Yeah, I think if you pile on the medicine, too much of it, you can actually do damage. And if you're, in particular, if you're behind the curve.
And you think the Fed is behind the curve.
I think they have been behind the curve. I see that they're reassessing things now. I just saw something cover the tape. Hopefully, they'll consider easing it. Because if you don't, if you're behind the curve with a lot of medicine, you actually are encouraging boom-bust cycles. And
meaning,
we don't want that.
And quantitative easing now, or stop the buybacks.
Yeah, you don't need it.
You're not,
the fragility isn't there. We're not that sick. There's reasons why unemployment is stubbornly high,
mm-hmm.
that don't have to do with some policy QE thing. okay? There are structural reasons for half of the unemployment that we have.